gracious God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Blessed be his kingdom, now and forever. Amen.
Hymn 390, verses 1 and 2.
House and ruler over all the land of Egypt. "Hurry and go up to my father and say to him, 'Thus says your son Joseph, God has made me Lord of all Egypt. Come down to me, do not delay. You shall settle in the land of Goshen, and you shall be near me, you and your children's children, as well as your flocks, your herds, and all that you have. I will provide for you there, since there are 5 more years of famine to come, so that you and your household and all that you have will not come to poverty.' And he kissed all of his brothers and wept upon them. And after that, his brothers talked to him." Hear what the Holy Spirit is saying to God's people.
Thanks be to God.
Pray a portion of Psalm 37 responsively, dividing at the asterisk. The psalm is printed in the bulletin insert. Do not fret yourself because of evildoers.
Do not be jealous of those who do wrong.
For they shall soon wither like the grass.
And like the green grass fade away.
Put your trust in the Lord and do good.
Dwell in the land and feed on its riches.
Take delight in the Lord,
and he shall give your heart's desire.
Commit your way to the Lord, and put your trust in him,
and he will bring it to pass.
He will make your righteousness as clear as the light,
and your just dealings as the midday.
Be still before the Lord,
and wait patiently for him.
Do not fret yourself over the one who prospers,
the one who succeeds in evil schemes.
Refrain from anger. Leave rage alone.
Do not fret yourself, it leads only to evil.
For evildoers shall be cut off.
But those who wait upon the Lord shall possess the land.
In a little while the wicked shall be no more.
You shall search out their place, but they will not be there.
But the lowly shall possess the land.
They will delight in the methods of peace.
But the deliverance of the righteous comes from the Lord.
He is their stronghold in time of trouble.
The Lord will help them and rescue them.
He will rescue them from the wicked and deliver them because they seek refuge in him.
Our epistle reading is St. Paul's masterful explanation of the resurrection of the dead. A reading from 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 35 through 38, 42 through 50. Someone will ask, how are the dead raised? With what kind of body do they come? Fool, what you sow does not come to life unless it dies. And as for what you sow, you do not sow the body that is to be, but a bare seed, perhaps of wheat or some other grain. But God gives it a body as he has chosen, and to each kind of seed its own body. So it is with the resurrection of the dead. What is sown is perishable. What is raised is imperishable. It is sown in dishonor. It is raised in glory. It is sown in weakness. It is raised in power. It is sown a physical body. It is raised a spiritual body. If there is a physical body, there is also a spiritual body. Thus it is written, the first man, Adam, became a living being. The last Adam became a life-giving spirit. But it is not the spiritual that is first, but the physical, and then the spiritual. The first man was from the earth, a man of dust. The second man is from heaven. As was the man of dust, so are those who are the dust. And as is the man of heaven, so are those who are of heaven. Just as we have borne the image of the man of dust, we will also bear the image of a man of heaven. What I am saying, brothers and sisters, is this. Flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, nor does the perishable inherit the imperishable. Hear what the Holy Spirit is saying to God's people.
Thanks be to God.
Can boomerang. Be easy on people. you'll find life a lot easier. Give away your life, you'll find life given back. But not merely given back with a bonus and blessing. Giving, not getting, is the way. Generosity begets generosity. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Brothers and sisters, let us continue to meditate on God's word for us in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. I went to the dentist this week and had something strange happen. And I don't mean just the dental procedure. I had a revelation in the dentist's chair. When I got in that chair, they had one of those all music stations playing on the television. And it was playing an old song, old Linda Ronstadt song. Remember this one? You're no good, you're no good, you're no good. Baby, you're no good. And they keep repeating those words. Four times in every verse, every refrain. And then the refrain keeps coming back again and again. I think they wanted to make certain, whoever wrote that song, that somebody got the message, you're no good. But the song wasn't the revelation I had. The revelation came in part because of what I was reading while I was waiting in the waiting room, the dentist's waiting room, just before. I was reading a book by a man named Richard Rohr. He is a Franciscan Roman Catholic priest living in New Mexico, running a conference center there. And his book is called Things Hidden. And he talks about the way we misread Scripture and how we might better approach it. And one of his major points is that there is a disconnect in our lives. A disconnect just like if you pull the plug on some electrical device, it will no longer work. He says there is a disconnect in our life. But the disconnect comes because we are disconnected from the source of our being. The very source of our being. And he goes all the way back to the beginning of Scripture in Genesis to explain what he means by that. Genesis tells us of God's creation, and especially this line. God created humankind in God's image. In the image of God, humankind was created male and female. And after those words of God's creation of humankind, God said, "It is very good." Not just "it is good," which was said of the rest of creation, the sun, the moon, and the stars, the animals, the trees, the plants, the bushes. Those are all just good. But humankind made in God's image was very good. So here would be that song sung from the point of view of the source of our being. You are good, you are good, you are good. God said, you are very good. But that's not the message we often get in society. All too often the message is, as it was in that Linda Ronstadt song, you're no good. You're no good. And it's what much of society seems to want to make us believe, or hope we will believe. In the simplest form of that, we see the ads on television that say, well, you might be okay, but you'll be better if you use this service or this product, that will make you much better. We have much blame putting in our society, much fault finding. And especially that gets applied to the characteristics of other human beings and their human nature. People we say are just the wrong color or the wrong ethnicity. And today, that's especially true if you happen to be Asian American. Or there's something wrong with your sexuality and the way you express it. And we could go on and on with the list of the ways that people say we're just not good. And some misguided Christians would like us to believe that also, that we are sinners, that there is nothing we can do about it, that we're just no good. And some people would even add in the explanation an expletive and say, you're no damned good, or use some other expletive. Richard Rohr says, the task of religion is simple. And one major task, it's to communicate not unworthiness, but union. Union with the source of our being, with our loving Creator, God. So if we do that, what difference does that union make? Well, we have wonderful examples of it today in the scripture readings we've had, of what difference very good people and their actions can make in the world. Our first reading from Genesis told of the story of Joseph, or the end of the story of Joseph. He had a rough life. His brothers were jealous of him, especially when his father gave him a coat of many colors. At one point, they sold him into slavery, hoping to get rid of him because of his view that he would someday rule over them. They didn't like that. Let's get rid of this troublemaker and sell him into slavery to these slave traders that are coming along. And they did. And then Joseph was imprisoned after being falsely accused of sexual behavior that he did not commit. He was imprisoned. And I wonder how any of us would feel after all of that. Sold into slavery, imprisoned, lied about. But look what this story told us. Joseph forgives. Forgives his brothers. Finds a place for them to live with his father and their children and their children's children. And it's a whole different way of approaching life. In our Old Testament readings this last week in the daily office, we had the story of Jacob and Esau, brothers born to Isaac. Jacob was a cheater. He cheated and stole his brother's birthright. Then, with his mother's help, he stole the elder blessing that the father would give to the elder child, and he was the second child. When Esau was furious with Jacob, Jacob fled, went away for years, married, and then became very wealthy and wanted to return. God called him to return. How would Esau react? Do you remember that story? How Jacob, when he was approaching Esau, decided that he'd plot his way into Esau's good graces. He'd send all these animals he had ahead of him as gifts for his brother. Then he would send some of his family and then others of his family, and last of all, he and his most favored children would come, and certainly Esau would be impressed. But Esau didn't care about that. Esau ran and hugged his brother, so happy was he to see him, not raging over past behavior, but pleased to be reunited with a long-lost brother. Marvelous story. The story is reflected in our psalm for today, Psalm 37, where the psalm tells us to stop fretting and goes on to say that it's a huge waste of time and energy to do all this fretting, this worrying, this plotting like Jacob did. It says, leave rage alone. Rage leads only to evil. Wow, how much we see of that in our world today. Leave rage alone. Rage only leads to evil. And the psalm urges us to trust in God. Be patient. Wait. God has better things in mind for us than rage and fretting. Our epistle reading from 1 Corinthians talks about that which God has in store for us someday. In God's eternity, something magical beyond our wildest imagination awaits us in God's eternity. But most of all, God wants us to find that in the here and the now. Not off someday, somewhere, that will come, but to make it in the here and the now. And that's what our gospel reading was about for today. It's almost a checklist of the way people who are really connected to the source of their being will behave. And especially in that version from the Message Bible that I read. Look that up. If you don't have the Message Bible, look it up online. You can find it. Just enter in Message Bible. It starts off, that version I read, with, be ready to receive the truth. And to me, that line says, be connected to the source. That's the way you can receive the truth and be ready to receive the truth. Be connected to what God has in mind for you. Listen. And that's what prayer really is. Prayer is listening, not so much laying out all the wishes and concerns that we have, but listening to what God has in mind for us. And that gospel reading is a marvelous list of what God has in mind for us now, in the here and now. And he starts the list with, love your enemies. In Peterson's version, he says, let your enemies bring out the best in you, not the worst. Isn't that great? Let your enemies bring out the best in you, not the worst. When someone gives you a hard time, respond with the supple moves of prayer for that person. Not revenge, not fretting, not rage, but prayer. That list went on with saying, no more payback, and live generously. Ask yourself what you want others to do for you, and then take the initiative and do it for them. Grab the initiative, that version said. It's the golden rule. The golden rule that all the great religions of the world have in common. Do unto others as you would have them do to you. If people who are down around you, really sad and depressed, don't condemn them. That version from Peterson said, that hardness with which you approach them can boomerang on you. It again is the reverse of the golden rule. If you lay that hardness on others, that hardness may come back to you. Instead, do to others what you'd like them to do for you. And give it. Not getting is the way. Generosity begets generosity. And that's the revelation I had. That if we can be connected to our source and not disconnected, we get a very different message from the message the world often gives. And the message isn't, you're no good. It's, you are good. You are good. You are good. You are very good, says our loving God. Amen. Stand and you are able to join me in our common statement of faith in our loving God, the Nicene Creed on page 358. We believe in one God, the Father.
Prayers of the People of Form 6, down on page 392 of the Book of Common Prayer. In peace we pray to you, Lord God, for all people in their daily lives at work.
For our families, friends, and neighbors, and for those who are loved.
For Joe, our President, Eric, our Governor, Thomas, our Mayor, this community, the nation, and the world. For the homeless, unemployed or underemployed, and for the just and proper use of your creation.
For the victims of hunger, fear, injustice, and oppression.
For those who are hospitalized, including Doug Haskell. Those in convalescent centers, Judith Austin, Teddy Fada, Sonia Burley, Barbara Moffat, Ella Mullen, Carol Smalling, Pat Zickel. For those who work to protect us, including the police, firefighters, and emergency personnel of our communities. Our men and women in the armed forces, Bobby and Billy Cole, Chastain Garner, Jessica Halliday, Brandon Hallowell, Gray, Chaz Hewlett, Micah Jones, Chris Call, Brian Casper, Amanda Conover McAllister, Melissa Payne, Reed Ressler, Travis Reed, Allison Woodruff, Ethan Lorch, and Zach Webb. For all who are in danger, sorrow, or any kind of trouble. For the peace and unity of the Church of God.
For all who proclaim the gospel and all who seek the truth.
For Michael, our presiding bishop, Jennifer, our bishop, Bill, our priest in charge. For our companion diocese, Brasilia and their bishop, Riccio, born in Sudan, their bishop, Reuben, the people of Haiti and their bishop, Sache. For the Episcopal Church in Jerusalem and the Middle East, in our Anglican cycle of prayer. For our diocese partners, St. John's Crawfordsville, the Reverend Mark Van Fossenhove. For all the baptized, and for all bishops and other ministers.
For all the servants of God and of His Church.
For the special needs and concerns of this congregation, including those on our printed prayer list.
For peace in the world, especially for peace in the Ukraine.
Hear us, Lord.
For your mercy is
great. Thank you, Lord, for all the blessings of this life. We pray for those who celebrate birthdays or anniversaries this week, including Randy Titus on February 21st, Teddy Fata on February 24th, Aubrey Bill and Cole on February 26th, and my true brothers, Vince and David, whose birthdays are this week. We give thanks for the altar flowers given today by James and Irene Alexander, and love in celebration of their 45th wedding anniversary on February 26th. Pray today for Phyllis Morris, Hal Nicholson, and Rob Olden on our daily prayer list. We will exalt you, O God, our King.
And praise your name forever and ever.
We pray for all who have died, including Sergeant Stephanie Thompson and her daughter, that they may have a place in your eternal kingdom. Lord, let your loving kindness be upon them.
And we put our trust in you.
We pray to you also for forgiveness of sins. Have mercy upon us,
most merciful Father. In your compassion, forgive us of our sins. Now and at the hour of our death. Amen. Thank you, God.
Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen. Sisters and brothers, the peace of the Lord is always with you. God's altar using Eucharistic Prayer C on page 369 in the prayer book. The Lord is with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give all thanks and praise.
God of all power, ruler of the universe, you are worthy of glory and praise.
Glory to you forever and ever.
At your command, all things came to be, the vast expanse of interstellar space. Galaxies, suns, the planets in their courses, and this now fragile earth, our island home. By your will they were created and have their being. From the primal elements you brought forth the human race and blessed us with memory, reason, and skill. You made us the stewards of creation, but we turned against you and betrayed your trust, and we turned against one another.
Have mercy, Lord,
for we are sinners in your sight. Again and again you called us to return. Through prophets and sages, you revealed your righteous law, and in the fullness of time, you sent your only Son, born of a woman, to fulfill your law, to open for us the way of freedom and peace.
By his blood he reconciled us. By his wounds we are healed.
And therefore we praise you, joining with the heavenly chorus, with Polycarp, Matthias, Otina, the Samaritan woman at Jacob's well, with prophets, apostles, and martyrs, and with all those in every generation who have looked to you in hope, to proclaim with them your glory in their unending hymn. Lord God of our fathers and mothers, God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, of Sarah, Ruth, Potina, and Mary, God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, open our eyes to see your hand at work in the world about us. Deliver us from the presumption of coming to this table for solace only and not for strength, for pardon only and not for renewal. Let the grace of this Holy Communion make us one body, one spirit in Christ, that we may worthily serve the world in his name. Risen Lord, be known to us in the breaking of the bread. Accept these prayers and praises, Father, through Jesus Christ, our great High Priest, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit, your church gives honor, glory, and worship from generation to generation. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Hallelujah! Christ, our Passover, is sacrificed for us.
Therefore, let us keep in peace. Hallelujah.
The gifts of God for the people of God. Holy gifts for God's holy people. Thank you. Let us pray. Eternal God, Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and you have fed us with spiritual food in the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace. The blessing of the God of Abraham and Sarah, of Jesus, born to our sister Mary, and of the Holy Spirit who broods over creation like a mother over her children, be among you and remain with you always. Amen.
Explanation of Tuesday, which we will celebrate next week.
I've discovered where I live there was a lot of interest in what we're doing next Sunday with Tazay, and lots of people asked me if we would share the website, the link with them, and I will certainly do that. I urge you to do the same. It's a marvelous service. There's a full explanation of it, as I said, in the bulletins today. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia. Let us go in peace, rejoicing in the power of God's presence with us.
Thanks be to God. Alleluia.